So this is a bloom test in MonoGame, and as you can see, we got a little bug here. When I hit the edge of the clamp, it changes the direction of the ship wrong. So I'll just fix that real quick. Show you what I did here. I'm animating the bloom saturation setting only. But let's go to that bug first. So I got this, which clamps to 20% of the screen's width on the left side, and 20%, and same with the height. The height minus 20% of the height of the screen is the bottom. This isn't working, I suspect, is because if, for example, the X direction gets clamped, the Y direction of the vector is still active, so it's going to be pointing straight down, straight up, because X will be zero. So to fix this, we need to make sure that we set our direction before we do the clamp. We'll do that right here. And the way this works is I got position and background being adjusted by velocity. The velocity is adjusted to be 20% of the difference between the mouse's current position and the mouse's previous position. It gives you a nice smooth blend of movement by changing the velocity that way. Let's make sure this works. Okay. It works as expected. And I'm going to turn on saturated because it's a little bit more glowy. I like it. All we're doing is changing the background position based on velocity. And the velocity is captured here. And so what I did for the background, I just draw a wrapped background like this using linear wrap. Pretty simple. The reason why I couldn't put these both in the same begin end is because I'm using the linear wrap sampler state for the background. So I draw the bloom layer over top with alpha blend. Otherwise I could put them both in non-pre-multiplied or alpha blend. Actually, I could change this. This could be opaque because this layer of background doesn't have any transparency. That's probably more efficient. So instead of using the component the way X and A did it, I just made it into a class. So the changes that you're probably wondering about with regards to the effects is, for example, the first thing we do is a bloom extraction. So you want your sampler set up like this. One thing to keep in mind, because we're using sprite batch to draw, and the way it does the vertex declaration is this vertex declaration format. So your vertex declaration for the input has to match the output for the vertex shader that sprite batch is using. That's why we have, you could just put these right in here, but I like doing it as a structure better because I can just copy and paste the structure into each of my effects. Put this in there, but you can do it however you want. I guess it's just as easy to copy and paste this in here. Actually, this can be color zero. Just, I don't think this has to be SV target zero, but so yeah, it still works. Another thing to keep in mind, actually, no, first I'm going to show you Gaussian. Same thing. This could be really handy if you wanted to do like make modifications to this and have some motion blurring effects based on the speed of the ship here in Bloom Combine. So this is where your shaders might seem to stop working from X and A when you port them over. For example here, for the second texture, you want to make sure to set it like this. Sampler, register, S1, S2, S3, so you assign your texture in here and you must pass the texture is a value. You can't say like texture 1 equals sort of thing. You have to actually pass it in as a parameter. And again, this has to match right here. At the current time, I noticed that made it as shader 4 and it does a loop. And it shouldn't be too many instructions for shader 4. It was saying that it's too many instructions for shader 2, even though I was specifying shader level 4 in both my vertex shader and my pixel shader. So I had to actually add a vertex shader to sort of bypass it of a vertex shader level 5 so that I could use pixel shader level 5. And then it wasn't counting. I think what it's doing is it's counting the number of instructions for shader 2. It's just probably a temporary bug. But I think pretty much everyone's going to be using 4 or 5 for their shaders nowadays anyway. So I think you have to use 3 for OpenGL. I'm not sure. Like, I'm not an expert on this stuff. I'm just... This was previously Bloom Component in the original X and A example. What I did was I changed it to just a regular class. I pass in the sprite batch that I want to use instead of making a new one in here. Passed in the presentation parameters, although you could probably extract them in here because you got the device here. Create the two render targets. These are half-size render targets because it's a little bit more efficient. You're using less video RAM and it's a little faster. I took out the clamp that was here because we're already doing that here. But there used to be a sample. Here you do the extraction of the bright regions. Here you do the horizontal blurring and vertical blurring effect. Then you set the destination and you do your final bloom. You can look at the effects to see how those work. They're fairly well commented already. One other thing to keep in mind, if you want to layer an effect over a scene, like for example, let's say I didn't want to do like a full screen bloom effect. I would only want to do it for certain things. I would set a render target for the layer that I want the blooms to happen on, and that's what I do here. I pass in the source render target. That's going to be the layer that we're going to put over top of the background that's going to have bloom effects added to them. I also passed in the destination render target. You could probably even return it here, but I like doing it this way better. So then it's going to draw to that destination when I set it here. It calls draw full screen quad. This is an important part right here. Before I wasn't doing this and I kept getting a black background and I was like, what the heck, I have alpha blend. And I set transparency up here, but I was forgetting that it keeps calling with different render targets. So you have to clear each render target as transparent, otherwise it won't necessarily be transparent. First of all, I draw the cursor, which is right here, which is actually a ship. And it rotates in the direction that we're moving, using this here. And the direction is just the vector based on the position and the previous position. And I rotate around the center right here, scale it by 1.5 just to make it a little bigger and put the rotation parameter in here. As you can see here, I could put a source rect if I was using a sprite sheet. I just put this to null because that means that we're just using the whole image. The animation of the pulse is pretty straightforward. All I did was add this so that it goes back and forth between the two levels of bloom saturation. Yeah, I think that's it. Beautiful. Clamping region. Instead of 20%, let's make it a little closer to the center. 40% from the center, that's the furthest it can get. And that way you can actually see potential obstacles or dangers coming towards you as you get close to them. And what you do for a game is you use the velocity to track world position, and based on where your screen is in the world, you can determine what's going to be visible. You can sort of partition your world into huge tiles and then subsections of tiles, and then associate positions of objects with those sort of tiles. They're not actually like tiles that you would draw, they're just coordinate tiles. And then that way, it's almost like a quad tree, but just a simplified quad tree method. And that way you know what's going to be visible, because it's only going to be in a section of tiles. And the section of tiles moves through memory as your ship moves through the world. It basically moves which section of tiles you're going to be looking at is kept track of that way. It would be pretty cool too to make an adaption of the Gaussian blur, so that when you move in a particular direction really fast, if you get like a power up or something, it does a background blur or something. Although that might be overkill, might not be necessary. Another thing you can do to make, you know, lasers and effects and stuff like that look a little more glowy is use additive blending. Like if I was to have this ship shoot lasers out and stuff, I would definitely choose additive blending for that. I would use the bloom and probably the additive blending too, or a combination of the two depending on how you want it to look. Like if you don't want it too transparent but you want to have a bit of a, just a bit of that additive glow effect, then you would mix the two together.